Our first season of podcast à la croisée des jeux is dedicated to running and more specifically to the marathon. It echoes the exhibition Free to Run on the road to the Paris 2024 marathon, which explores the social revolution of the marathon and tells the stories of how personal and social freedom were conquered through the sport of running. Today, we have the pleasure of welcoming Catherine Switzer, the first woman to run the Boston Marathon as an officially registered competitor in 1967. À la croisée des jeux, the series that brings together sport and culture, exploring the influence of the Olympic Games on you, on us, on our imagination and society, produced by the Olympic Museum. My name is Véronique Legrand. I'm a specialist in sustainable health and performance and founder of the En Mouvement Lausanne Center, dedicated to physical activity and artistic performance. With our guest Catherine Switzer, we will speak about the running and its relationship to her fight for gender equality. We will discuss her experience in the 1967 Boston Marathon and her activism around female runners and women in sports. Hi, Catherine.
Hello, Véronique.
Nice to meet you and welcome to the À la croisée des jeux podcast. It's a real pleasure for us to be speaking with you today.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here.
Yeah. You're a runner, a noter, a journalist and commentator, the first registered woman to compete at the Boston Marathon in 1967 and the winner of the New York City Marathon in 1974 in 3:07 minutes. Congratulations, with a personal best time of 2 hours 51 in 1975. You were named Female Runner of the Decade in 1967 and received an Emmy Award for your commentating work. You created a social revolution by empowering women around the world through running and have launched a non-profitable association called 261 Fearless. So, wow, what a career, and I'm really happy to have you here today, Catherine. Welcome.
Thank you so much, Véronique, and I would like to also thank the IOC for recognizing women in such a big way and these historical moments in our progress.
Yeah. So may we start with the first question. Catherine, you started running when you were a student in your 20s. What brought you to running and how did you start training for the marathon?
Well, actually, I started running when I was 12 years old. And I started running because my father saw that I was going into high school and I was a skinny and prepubescent little girl. But I was going into a very big school with 1,500 students. And I was really intimidated, and he knew that I needed something to give me a sense of strength. And so he said that our school had a field hockey team for girls and that I should play on that team. And I said I couldn't do it. I didn't have any background in that. And he said, all you need to do is run a kilometer a day and you would be the best person on that team. And I said, oh, I couldn't even do 1 kilometer. And he said, sure you can. I'll show you how. And he said wonderful things like, you know, life is for participating, not spectating. You should just run this mile a day and not worry about, you know, how fast you go. It's all about completion, not about speed. And I started running this kilometer, really a mile a day. And I really got wonderfully empowered by it. I felt like I had a victory under my belt. Nobody could take away from me. And it was such a powerful feeling that when I tried out for the sports teams in my school, I was good at all of them because I never got tired and I had such great fitness. And but I thought it was magic. And I joke and say, you know, I've been running for 64 years now and it's still magic. It really, really is. But anyway, in my 20s, I was at university And there I asked the track coach if I could run on the men's team, because by that time I was very confident. And he said, no, it's a men's team, but we wouldn't mind if you came and trained with the team. And that's where I met a volunteer coach who was really old, because I was only 19. And this volunteer coach was 50, and he had run the Boston Marathon 15 times. And as he ran with me every day, he took me under his wing. He was a really, really nice guy. He took me under his wing, and he would tell me all these stories about the marathon. And I fell in love with the idea. And I fell in love with the idea because I didn't have the speed to go fast, but I could run forever. And yeah. This coach loved that. And he started getting back into shape too. And one night, I told him I wanted to run the Boston Marathon. And he got very angry, and he said, you can't run a marathon. Women can't run that far. And I said, no, a woman ran last year in the Boston Marathon. Her name was Roberta Gibb. And he said, no woman ever ran a marathon. And I said, hey, you've got to believe that a woman can. And he said, I'll tell you what, if you show me in practice that you can run the distance, I'd be the first person to take you to Boston. So he trained really hard, and the day came to run 42 kilometers. And when we finished the 42 kilometers, I said, I don't think we ran far enough. Let's run another 8 kilometers. So we ran 50 kilometers. And at the end of the workout, my coach fainted. And when he woke up, he said, women have hidden potential in endurance and stamina. And that's when we discovered a long time ago. Now, this is 56 years ago. We discovered that women have really tremendous capability and endurance and stamina, and can go the distance. We don't have the speed and power of men, but
yeah,
it does.
For sure.
Yeah, it doesn't mean we're worse athletes. It means we're different athletes. So, and it's changing the sport today. So that was the beginnings of my running.
And I so was you would say that a mile a day keep the doctor away.
Yeah, a mile a day keeps the doctor away. But I think the important part of this story also is that two men were important in my life in terms of my running. I wasn't influenced by women. I was influenced by men.
That's beautiful. We'll go a bit longer on your influences with women, but with the participation of men on the later question. You spoke about Roberta Gibb. So you knew that she ran, actually, in 1966.
66, yeah.
Yeah, I knew that Roberta she had Gibb. Participated.
Yeah. I knew because I had a boyfriend who ran the Boston Marathon in 1966, and that was the first time I ever heard about it. And I said, wow, that's great. I said, did any girls run? And he said, yeah, one did, and she ran really well. And so I said, okay, well, great. You know, it's okay for women to run it.
Yeah, because she was the first one that to be known, huh? to run the unofficially the Boston Marathon, and the year later when you decided to run in 1967, you decided to run in, as you just said, with your coach. So what were exactly your motivation at that time to succeed? As you said, you wanted to also to prove that women can do it, but what was the inside motivation to participate to this marathon?
The inside motivation was it was my reward because I proved to my coach that a woman could run the marathon. So, I mean, it was a challenge to him, and he promised to take me to Boston. But don't forget, Boston was considered one of the biggest, most famous races in the world. It was like second to the Olympic Games, and it was going to be great being there. I was really excited. And I wasn't there to prove anything politically, because a woman had already run it, so I didn't need to prove that. But I really was a little nervous about myself, of course, but I had a great confidence because I had done 50 Ks in practice.
Of course, yes, of course. And so the first year, of course, you were not accepted as a woman, huh? And we all know your story, beautiful story. So what was your path to be accepted as a woman in that sport? Could you tell us a bit more what the behind the scene, that all the paths you had to go through?
All through my high school years and into college, into university, I was a registered athlete with the Amateur Athletic Union, which was the official federation of the United States. So I ran track. I ran 800 meters. I ran cross country. But the marathon was something, you know, that women hadn't run except for Roberta. And so I thought, okay, well, I'm going to run this also. But the support, there wasn't a lot of support for women's running. Certainly at university, there were no women's teams whatsoever in any sport, much less in the running sport. So it was something I had to do outside of the university. Anyway, other women, when I tried to get them to run with me, weren't particularly interested. But the women who did run on these official meets were terrific. You know, they were very, very good athletes. So I was inspired by them. But anyway, my motivation to run Boston was simply to run that great race. It was a great goal to have run that and have it as a life accomplishment. It's sort of like climbing Kilimanjaro, you know, you can, you have that opportunity. But I think everybody knows the story that when I went to run it, my coach insisted that I sign up for the race. And he said, look, you're a registered member of the federation. You've got to sign up for the race and pay your entry fee and put down your right numbers and everything else. And I said, what if they don't want me in the race? And he said, and I said, there's nothing in the rule book. And we went through the rule book. And I said, there's also nothing about gender on the entry form. And that's because he said, that's because nobody would believe a woman would want to run, much less could run. So why are they going to make a rule about it? And I said, yeah, but do you think I'm going to be creating any problems? And he said, no. He said, all the guys are going to like you in the race. And he said, and I said, but I'm going to be noticed. And he said, yes, you are. And he said, and I'm proud of you. It was a really amazing moment. So, you know, I was ready to go. I wasn't there to prove anything politically. All the guys I ran with always were very accepting of me. And the women who ran, of course, also. So at Boston, when I showed up, I was there. All the men were really great. They would come over to me and say, I wish my wife would run. I wish my girlfriend would run. Give me some tips to get her started. And we're supporting you all the way. And they were great.
Beautiful. So you mentioned that you will be noticed, which, yeah, it's just what exactly happened. So you received a fantastic media coverage. And then this is the start when you started to fight for women inclusion in long distance and running competition. Can you tell us a bit, what did you realize within the movement you created that make you wanted to go through with this women inclusion?
Yes. After I was attacked by the race director in the race and the photographs and the controversy then was in all of the media, really around the world, I felt enormously responsible. And I felt that I had to really change things because it was very, very polarizing. The publicity was largely negative or funny. Like, look at this girl. She's running in a man's race, you know, and look what happens to women when they go to places where they're not invited or they can't do it anyway. But of course, I did do it. And that's what upset them so much. At first, some of the reporters even said I didn't finish. And that really made me very angry. And one of them was a reporter from the New York Times. And I called him and I said, hey, look, you know, I really did finish the race. And I gave him, you know, my background and everything. And then the next thing was, there was this big story in the New York Times and brought up the subject, well, why aren't we letting them run? So that created an ongoing battle of people who said women shouldn't be participating and other people who said, well, it's a free country and the roads are free for everybody. Why not? But I was expelled from the Athletic Federation for doing it. And I mean, that's like being in the Catholic Church and being excommunicated, you know? Yeah. It was like saying, you can't compete now in anything because you poison all the races. Well, that was ridiculous. So what I did with my coach, because my coach was expelled also, we started creating our own club. And we created our own club and got other people out on the roads to run. And a little club in a small place like Syracuse, New York, became one of the biggest clubs in New York. And suddenly I began learning how to do marketing and get sponsorship and create publicity for us. And, you know what? I never said anything negative about the Federation, but I waited my time and I started taking leadership roles in the Federation. I was brought back into being an athlete. I was allowed to re-register and I started working in the system. You have to work in the system.
To be able to change it, yeah, for
absolutely.
Sure.
And so I was an influence and I took jobs that people didn't want, of course. And then people began realizing, well, let's have a women's division in this race. And then we began, you know, fighting for inclusion in races of, you know, 10Ks and then 15Ks and 30Ks. But the marathon was our big one. And Nina Cusick and Sarah Mae Berman from Nina's from New York. I was from upstate New York and Sarah was from Boston. We began working very hard with our different federations in those different areas. And another thing we did is we enlisted the support of men. The men were always helpful, especially with the different federation called the Roadrunners Club of America. They really were very helpful and they exerted a lot of influence in their communities. Then we began getting medical evidence together because one of the big things was everybody said, all these federations would say, yes, but it might be dangerous for women. So we have to protect our women. And we said, well, you know, what's there to protect us from? We're perfectly healthy. And they said, well, you might not be able to have children. And Nina Cusick said, I've got three children. What are you telling me?
So you work closely with Nina Cusick and the other woman then, because she in 1972, actually, she was the first woman to win officially the Boston Marathon. And she created also this petition with you. So then I guess you were in this community. I guess at that time the community was close enough to be able to share it and to brought it up to front together, yeah?
Yes, well, we were between Boston and New York. So, I mean, we were within driving distance and certainly we were on the telephone a lot. But yes, it's funny how we divided the work. Nina loved the legislation and going to the meetings and working with the rule change. I hate that kind of work, that admin work. But what I was good at was marketing and promotions and creating events to prove that women would run. And Sarah Mae Berman lived in Boston, so she worked very closely working with the Boston Athletic Association so that we could be official in Boston. And in 1972, it was really remarkable because they really relented and finally they admitted women into the Boston Marathon. But this took 5 years of work. This was 5 years in the life of an athlete, which is tremendously a long period of time.
It's very long.
But anyway, we were there. There were eight women who could meet the qualifying time. We had to meet the men's qualifying time, by the way. Anyway, there were eight of us who ran, showed up, we registered, we ran, and all eight of us finished. And last year in 2022, the five of us who are left celebrated our 50th anniversary there together. And it was huge, really a huge event. Even Adidas dedicated the whole clothing line to us. And my signature is actually in the label of the clothing, which is really nice. Very
beautiful.
Nice.
Yeah. It's for me, it's an amazing story because when you look past, we still, as a woman, we still have huge fight today, but it's beautiful to see how the history came and how you divided the part and how you choose which one is the best to make front together. So it's very inspiring. So maybe we go on. So in 1977, you met the cosmetic company Avon, and that's what you said, you were good at creating events. So I guess this goes through with the marketing to take a woman cosmetic company that were interested to sponsor the running event for women. So could you explain us the goal and the importance at that time for such events for women? And how, in a way, that would pave the way to the integration for the women's marathon?
After we got official in the Boston Marathon in 1972, then the goal became get the women's marathon in the Olympic Games. And people thought we were crazy because it was such a big goal. The Olympic Games, the Olympic company actually moves very, very slowly. And in those days, it was the longest event in the Olympic Games. before 1972 was only 800 meters. So in 72, they let in the 1500 meters. And we thought, oh my God, it's going to be 2012 before we even get a marathon in, but we want to go faster than that. How can we do that? And the argument was there are not enough participating countries and there are not enough women. So I thought if we had women's only races in all these different countries, we could get the women to show up and they would come and run. Well, I thought this was a great idea. And I wrote a marketing proposal and a public relations proposal. And I thought, well, who am I going to take this to? And I thought, well, I'm going to take it to Avon Cosmetics because I had met the people there at a cocktail party once, a sports cocktail party. They were doing some events with women's tennis. And then they had said, oh, I read about you in the newspaper. How interesting. So I said, I'd like to talk to you about maybe other sponsorships. And they said, sure, sure. But I thought they were being polite, you know. But anyway, I decided it was important to practice. And I wrote a very, very good proposal on how a multinational company like Avon, who did business in 125 countries, could sponsor a women's event. And we could then go from country to country, gather the different international participation requirements, and show the numbers and show the participation. And we also, again, would work on the medical point where these we could present this data to the International Olympic Committee, who still were very nervous about countries where women were highly protected, and they thought that they would become not feminine anymore. So I didn't think Avon in a million years would like this proposal, but they loved the proposal, and they hired me. And I couldn't believe it. It was like, oh my God, I can't believe this. But they only wanted to do one event. And so we put on a marathon only in America. It was the first time we brought in all these international countries. And it was so successful publicity-wise for them. They decided to do a pilot program in America and then to do two events internationally. And then pretty soon countries began saying, we want a race in our country. And the federations in those countries, though, were extremely difficult. Many of them said, almost all of them said, the race isn't going to be successful. The women aren't going to show up. And I said, well, if you don't mind, we're going to go ahead and organize the race. And they said, okay, but nobody will come. Well, thousands of women came. And it was huge. In places like Japan, in the Philippines, Malaysia, Brazil, where they didn't even have women's sports events, it was amazing.
Huge.
Because the women, for the first time, felt like they own the streets. It was amazing.
That's amazing. So it took them 10 years to be able to go to the Olympics. So for 10 years, you organized marathon and running for women, yes?
Yes, but we got the vote to go into the 1984 games in 1980. Actually, 81.
Yeah, 4 years before, yeah.
Yeah, 4 years before, because the votes are decided 4 years before. And it was a special, special race. We closed downtown London streets in 1980 for the first time in history for a sports event. It was that race became what is now the London Marathon. And that was the design model. And we had the Olympic Committee said you needed three continents and 24 countries. We had 27 countries and five continents. So we exceeded that requirement, and they called a special meeting with the board of directors in February of 1981, where the vote was taken, and the vote was 9-1 of the board of directors. And Madame Monique Berlioz, who was then the executive director, made the announcement at the press conference, and she said, this was not an easy fight for the women, but it's a very important victory.
Yeah, it's beautiful. And this is where you explore the relation between men and women. And you get, because as you said, without the support of these men, mostly were men in the border. And so that's why. Can you tell us a bit more this relation? Because that was the relation with men and the support with women that make it work together. So would you be able to explain a bit?
Sure. More? Okay. So all through our campaign from 1967 on, men who ran were supportive of us. Then the men who ran and they were in charge of events and sports and clubs were supportive of us. And then the journalists began being supportive of us because they were just reporting what they knew. Once they were educated, they were good. Then the men who were doctors, because most doctors in those days were men, did the medical evidence for us. And then major people in federations began helping us in a big way. Key in this was a guy by the name of John Holt, who was the executive director of the what was then called the International Amateur Athletic Federation, which is now World Athletics. Yeah. He was really key. And he told me that I should make a relationship with the men in the Los Angeles Olympic Organizing Committee, in particular, Peter Uberoth, who was the president. And when I went to California to meet with him and his staff, they wanted the women's marathon because they saw women running all over California and they thought it would be a wonderful addition. So they supported it and they took the vote to Moscow, where they couldn't make the decision in Moscow. So they tabled the decision for this special meeting the following February. So all of those guys and the guys who were head of in the IOC, I'm thinking of somebody like Lance Cross, for instance, from New Zealand. Unfortunately, a lot of these people are dead now, but Lance Cross from New Zealand, for instance, was very, very supportive. So they spoke out at the meeting and said, we support the women. They were very, very key because there were no women on these committees.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's why for me, it's fantastic because you explain really well that it's not just a matter of fact to be able to broad women in the streets, but it's to convince on different ways, from the medic part, then for the consciousness and the right. So I think it's beautiful how you organized in order to touch base on each point of section. So yeah, beautiful.
I must say, Veronique, it was amazing. You know, to go. The most important thing I think was going personally to meet with them, and fortunately, I had a sponsor who would help me with that. When I say, look, I really need to go to London to talk to John Holt, or I really need to go to Los Angeles to talk to Peter Uberoth, just meeting them and being personable and putting the case to them, they were fair people. Of course. I think, you know, you get much more done when you can meet on an eye-to-eye basis and talk rather than saying, you stupid idiot, of course women should run. People don't go, oh, I'm not going to listen to this. But if you say, look, here are all these women running and they see them in the streets. Yeah, it really worked. It worked.
Yeah, wise way, just not to fight. It's a way to fight, but to understand and to go to communication. So let's go through this communication because you prove a certain talent. And so also that you made your work and your living out this communication, being the first woman journalist commentating the race of the ABC channel in 1984. So what's for you the experience of being able, you brought all this movement and then you were able to commence the first women to win the race. So can you tell us a bit this experience about the 1984 run?
Yes, it was both conflicting and wonderful. I was trying very hard. I was an American commentator on an American network, but I knew that many of our voices were also going to go globally. And honestly, I didn't want to show any favoritism to the American women any more than the Norwegian women who I thought were going to win, or to the Japanese women who were there, which was wonderful too, but whatever. So I was trying to speak from a global point of view about how the race was going and about the progress we had made with this. It was really, really important. But it was an amazing race also because, you know, it was being broadcast to 2.2 billion people. And when Joan Benoit made her move in the race, it was so early and it was so strong that you normally would say there's not a hope that this person is going to win because they're taking too much of a risk on a warm day. But she had made that charge and really it was a very, very valiant race and she won. Greta Weitz, I thought, was going to really win the race, or Inger Christensen. But they thought, no, she's going too soon. We won't go. And by the time they went, the train had left the station. So it was very, very dramatic.
Yeah, I imagine. And also the dramatic when the Swiss Gaby Anderson, she arrived, that you maybe saw that it could lead to a lot of criticism and to rain down all what you went up. So what was the emotion behind that? Because you had kind of the first that she was amazing and really strong, and then the Swiss one, which arrived very dehydrated and weak. So
yeah, well, what happened is that I felt very sorry for Gaby Anderson because the Swiss people were giving her a very hard time about making a qualifying time, which I thought was unrealistic. And she was already 40 years old and a top masters athlete, as well as, you know, an open women runner. But this was very unrealistic, and she had to chase this goal. And she probably ran 3 marathons that year to make the qualifying time. But she did, and she was running. So when she ran, I'm sure she was tired. And she wasn't going to have another Olympics. So, you know, this was it for being 40. So she gave it her all on a hot day. When she came in utterly dehydrated and exhausted, it was not a beautiful sight, but it was a courageous sight because she refused to quit. And everybody says, oh, her mind is not working. Well, her mind was fine. Her body was failing her. And she would push people away. No, don't touch me. Let me finish. And when she finished, the crowd erupted. They didn't see it as a weakness. They saw it as a valor, as courage. And everybody was just screaming in the stadium for her. It was huge. It was huge. The next morning at a press conference, she was perfectly fine. You know, she just needed some saline injection. But for me as a commentator, I was really scared because I suddenly remembered the history back in 1928 when they allowed the women's marathon in Amsterdam for the first time in the Olympic Games. And they claimed that 3 women collapsed at the finish, and that it was a disgrace to womanhood and that we have to protect our women from this ever happening. Well, it was not true. You know, that was a really a conspiracy of journalism. And public fervor after the war about protecting our women. So I was afraid they might pull the marathon, but instead they didn't. And they said that this was really a very, very important moment. To me, and I said this in that wonderful film, Free to Run, yes, that to me that the women's marathon in the 1984 Olympic Games was as important as giving women the right to vote. Because it was the longest running event for men or for women in the Olympic Games. And women running it in the same games showed that women had a physical equivalent to men and a physical acceptance, whereas the vote is our intellectual and social acceptance. So it finally...
It's similar.
To me.
Absolutely.
And because around the world, everybody watched this event, you know? And television took it to 2 billion people. And they all know how far 42 kilometers is and 26.2 miles. They know it's a long way.
For you, it was also a personal achievement as a journalist on one side, but also as a runner, because you lead to this game, right?
I think for me, the triumph of the 1984 Olympics and the women's marathon was not me as a journalist, but was, I think, me as somebody who helped organize and make it happen as an event. That was a beautiful, wonderful thing. It was a life triumph. Was I sorry I wasn't in the Olympic Games? No, because I knew all my life, I knew that if that event were in the Olympic Games, I didn't have the talent to be that good. And I wanted the women who had the talent to be able to show it and inspire everybody else. That was the thing that excited me the most about that event.
And this is also what you're still doing, right? To lead with your association, to lead women to run, to be able to create events through the world and to make women free to run.
Absolutely. One of the most important things about running is the fact that it makes you fearless and free, grateful. It is empowering on every front. Women who run have changed their lives completely in many ways. They can finish their education. They can ask for a better job. They can leave a bad relationship. They can create things that they never believed they could do before. It's very, very important. And it's really amazing that my old BIB number, 261, has become 261 Fearless.
Fearless, yeah, beautiful. Yeah,
was named that because people were writing to me saying that that BIB number, 261, makes me feel fearless. That whole story makes me feel fearless. Running has changed my life. It makes me feel fearless. And when they began sending me pictures of their tattoos with 261, I said, I have to do something with this. What can I do? Because I always felt, even after the Olympic Games in 1984, about a week later, I said, well, this was wonderful for the women who could train and have access to running. What about the women who can't even go out of their house? What about women who can't get an education, not allowed to drive a car, not allowed to choose their husband, much less run? We've got to reach them because running is easy and cheap and accessible. We can do it. And so 261 Fearless has a series of community clubs and meet runs all over the world. We're in 13 countries now. We're very young. We're only 8 years old. And, and we're growing greatly. And I truly believe that running has changed the world for women, and it will continue to change the world.
It's beautiful. Are you still, can I ask you a personal question? Are you still running?
Oh, absolutely. I'm still running. Running is my life. And, you know, it's the same feeling of magic that I had when I was 12 years old. It's really important. So I've been running, as they say, for 62 years. But here's another great story about aging. All right.
That was my next question about aging, because in Switzerland, we have a lot of fear. And I'm a physiotherapist. I'm specialized in sports. And that's true that many people, they say, no, running is bad for your joint. Running is bad for your knee. So the consciousness is still on the fact that impact is not that good. And specifically for aging. And I was telling my grandmother, she had Parkinson and she was not able to walk. And I was telling her, you should run because running is better. And actually she was better running than walking. And many people with disease, they are better running than walking. And that's why I'm curious about what do you think about running and aging, which I think we don't speak that much about that.
Well, we're speaking a lot about it now, actually, that running really forestalls the aging process in a huge way. And a friend of mine who is a very noted gerontologist said the most important organ in our body as we age is not our brain, but our legs, because the legs pump hard and it pumps oxygen to the brain.
Absolutely.
It keeps you from getting dementia, which is now a test. It prevents heart disease, and also for women especially, it helps prevent osteoporosis, which is a bone thinning. And when you stress the bone by running on it and doing that impact, you in fact increase, it grows the bone back stronger. So exercise is critically important to aging. I had the happiest day of my life was April 17th, 2017, when I ran the Boston Marathon again on my 50th anniversary. I was the first woman to do that. To run a marathon 50 years later. Now, that's not because of my greatness. It's simply because so few women ran. But when I ran, and I ran only 24 minutes slower than I did when I was 20, I did 13 interviews. I did hugged every child along the way. When I crossed the finish line, I was surrounded by 13,500 women who were wearing an official bib number in the Boston Marathon. The race was at last 50-50. My husband was there, Joanne Flaminio, the first woman president of the Boston Athletic Association, was there. And I said, yeah, now we're there. Now
you
we're
did
there.
It. Yeah.
It was, and I want to tell every woman who's listening to this, and every man too, is that running is so cheap and so easy, and it is God's gift for health. It gives you everything. My husband is 84 years old, and he just said, another New Zealand running record.
Beautiful. Thank you, Catherine. I think we'll end with you those beautiful words. So really thank you, Catherine Switzer, for this beautiful discussion and the engagement and inspiration that you're transmitting. You're really a role model. So it was very, for me, an honor to share this moment with you as this podcast. And I also, you comment the Free to Run movie. And so I take an advantage to say again that the exhibition that just started last week, Free to Run, that can be viewed at the Olympic Museum in Lausanne until the 5th of March, 2024. So thank you, Catherine, and I hope to see you soon. And for all the people who listen to us, you will also find online on the Google Art and Culture platform interactive stories with original images and videos on female marathoner who have conquered long-distance races and the marathon. The link in the desk is in the description of this podcast. And if you enjoyed this episode, please let us know by commenting or rating in on your favorite listening network. So have a beautiful day, Catherine, and thanks again.
Thank you, Véronique, and thank you to the IOC again, and thank you to Free to Run.